CCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening and welcome to Berks Arts on BCTV. Thanks so much for tuning in. We're at the beginning of June here and summer is upon us, and there are so many great things going on throughout the Reading community and Greater Berks community. So make sure that you sign up for our email list at www.berksarts.org so you can hear more about all the great concerts outside. Our Bandshell series has been announced, and that information is also available on our website, which is www.berksarts.org. And we look forward to seeing everybody out there. We'll have more in the Bandshell concerts over the summer during the July program. We also look forward to seeing everybody at the brand new Reading Blues Fest. The announcement for that will be coming out on June 10th, so keep your eyes peeled. We've got some great artists, and that will be for our Fall Blues Festival, and that is readingbluesfest.com. So summer means a lot of things to a lot of people, and some of it is summer camps, and some of it is getting outside and doing things. So I've got two great guests with me today. Richard Bradbury from the Olivet Center for the Arts, Olivet Powell Center for the Arts, and Mike Miller from the West Reading Museum of Temporary Art. So guys, thanks so much for coming on.
Thanks for having us.
So, we've got we've got camps for kids, and we've got activities for all ages. So, Mike, we're going to start over on the end with you,
okay,
with the West Reading Museum of Temporary Art. Did I get that right?
Right.
Okay.
WERMOTA is the
MOTA.
Acronym. WERMOTA.
Yeah. WERMOTA, that's
WERMOTA.
Right. WERMOTA. So what, well, what on earth is a Museum of Temporary Art? And because you don't have a building.
Right.
But you have lots of buildings, or parts of buildings?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of, over the past few years, West Reading has been developing a body of public art through the mural corridors,
yes,
with Dean Rohrbach and the West Reading Community Revitalization Foundation. I kind of have always envisioned those, like once the murals are up, they're there. So I was thinking of how can we make a body of work that would just be up for a shorter period of time? So it kind of create sort of a sense of urgency.
So you've got, and it's an exhibition.
Right, it's an exhibition. So the same way museums have a permanent collection.
Yeah.
So the murals are sort of our permanent collection. And we go to museums to see the show that's there right now, and while we're there, we'll see the permanent collection also. So that was kind of part of the reason for it. Plus, it's always a challenge to make work to last, and this was an opportunity to just think about, let's just do things for a short period of time.
No pressure.
Right, right. Experimenting more with materials and not worrying about longevity. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to create sort of a body of work that would work with artists, not just necessarily local artists, but artists from all over the world. And this was an idea I'd been thinking about for years, and I ran into a former student, Justin Seibert, and his partner, Kayla Mathis, and they worked together as an art duo called Best Test. And they met at Rhode Island School of Design, and they create work that really works with social engagement. And I told them about this idea that I wanted to make this, you know, temporary exhibit that would work with international artists and be very discreet works of art, tiny. And they said, well, if you want to work with us, you know, we kind of teamed up, and that's how, you know, WERMOTA was sort of hatched.
So
we began planning it.
Tiny artworks.
Right, tiny. So we're actually calling them micro murals. So the scale of them is 2 by 8 inches. And I actually had a couple artists contact me and said, inches, right? Not feet. I'm like, yeah, just inches. So it's the scale of a brick. And
okay.
West Reading is a town of bricks.
Yes.
So we thought that's going to be one brick would be the wall. So we actually...
So you reached out to Justin and Kayla, is that
Kayla?
Kayla,
yeah.
And how did you contact? You said artists from all over the world, so
right.
We'll get that, and then we'll sort of dive into some of the artwork.
Yeah.
Too,
so
the idea
to get the artists, Kayla did a lot of the curation, and she met a lot of artists just through Instagram and approached them that way. I approached just some local artists that I knew. And once we began negotiating sites, we wanted to somehow give the artist inspiration that we wouldn't just say create a work of art 2 by 8 inches, whatever you want.
Brick, yeah.
But we wanted to give them some inspiration. So we ended up recording stories from the residents or the store owners or just people who grew up in West Reading. So it really became a story project and sort of an oral history project. And we collected dozens and dozens of stories. I teach a class at Wyomissing High School called Public Art Workshop. A lot of my students recorded stories, negotiated sites as part of the course, and we sent those stories to the artists. So then the artists created the works inspired by the story.
Okay, so you have stories and you have bricks. And you have artists from all over the world.
All over the world.
Yeah. So how do I find these bricks?
So that was the challenge with this, and that's why I was really
I haven't stumbled across them at the farmer's market.
Yeah, they're there.
I'm not looking in the right places.
So that's why I was so grateful that I was working with Justin and Kayla, because I had no idea. I knew there was probably going to need to be some sort of map or maybe a digital element, and Justin does a lot of programming, so he's created a website and also an app that allows people to, with a smartphone, find them. But then we've also created a map.
Yeah, so I picked up a map at the farmer's market.
And the maps are available that you can see where they're located. There's actually a physical map, and then also it shows the addresses and where the artists are from.
And there is information on the website, which is wrmoda.org. So we're here at the website. So we've got that. And with that, there's you can download the app. It gives you an example. And it certainly tells a little bit about it, and there is a copy of the map for those of you who would rather not check out, who would rather not download an app, or if you have a smartphone.
Yeah, can you click on the map for a moment?
I can.
Yeah, we ended up getting sites for the map. They go from Reading Avenue, which is a block north of Penn Avenue. We have many pieces on Penn Avenue itself, but then it goes further south into Franklin Street, Chestnut Street,
and
the whole way down to the West Reading Pool.
So, and I noticed they're color coded. What do all the colors mean?
Right. So once we had all the sites determined, the stories were recorded, they were out with the artists, I began to work with a humanities class from Wyomissing High School, and they began to do a lot of the audio editing of the stories, and then also write summaries so that on the app and people could just have a brief synopsis of what each story would be. And they began to see different themes that emerged from all these stories, because there's 110 works of art.
Yeah, 110,
yeah. So they found different themes related to moving, related to love, related to loss, nostalgia. And so they wanted to somehow, show those themes. So that's where the color coordination came
and
from.
And how long are these stories?
They range from a minute to 2 or 3 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So and if we're going to go back to the website, and you can listen to the stories on the app, and we'll show the app.
Right.
But if we go back to the website, there is one example here. First of all, you have this artwork.
Yeah, and it's at the West Reading Pool House.
Is the artist Sophie Ramos, or is the storyteller
Sophie? The artist is Sophie Ramos. Yeah.
So.
everybody went. It got crowded. They had all kinds of stands set up. I think they might have had little... I was in charge of the candy stand, and I'd go into town to Wynn Outlet, which was up near 10th and Penn.
Okay.
And I'd go back. They were my friends, and we'd pick out. I'd pick out all the boxes of candy, and he would hardly ever charge me anything. But when I would ring up at the end of the carnival, they would say, "How did you make so much money here?" I mean, a lot. But that was because they didn't charge me much.
Right, you had a good
and
profit margin.
And then you got candy cigarettes, which my daughter and I love. You would get 24 boxes of candy cigarettes in a big box for like $2.
Oh, my
gosh. That's all they were.
Yeah.
And then you could sell them at that time.
And that was probably a really popular candy.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
They went. I used to get a couple of boxes.
Uh-huh.
And they were the original candy cigarettes that were... not hard like the ones they make now. These were soft and...
Okay, like, you know, they like Big Became
like
Chewing Gum?
No.
No.
Well, they had chewing gum ones, but I only ever got the white.
Okay.
And then when you bit into it, it was like vanilla tasting.
Yeah.
So I get all kinds of candy, and I love doing that candy stand every
year.
I'll do the candy stand.
That's great.
So that
you've
was...
you've got this woman of the past, and... you know, the artwork, as you see it, you can see the colors of candy wrappers, and you can feel that joy that's, you know, the fun of the carnival and just that great feeling.
And I think that's the neat thing is, like, the woman who told that story, I don't know what her experience is with contemporary art, but, like, this piece really, you know, has a sensibility, and I think it it gives you greater appreciation for that work of art, knowing the story where it, you know, where it originated. So you're standing at the pool house where that carnival took place years ago. You're listening to the story in the voice of the person whose memory it was.
Really
and
nice.
You're seeing this work of art. And then the website or the app also can take you to the artist's website. So then if you're really intrigued by the art, you can look at that artist's whole body of work on their website.
And I know the website on your website, there is where you can download here on either for your Apple or your Android, but there is a little bit here about you can view some of the artists because they're and just get a scope, you know, looking just doing a quick look of where everybody is from, and it's just, it really is amazing. So you do have, click on Elliot here.
Yeah.
So it'll take you to his website, but not necessarily, in order to find his artwork in West Reading, you have to use either the app or the map.
Right. So, and what was interesting about, it's funny you chose Elliot Fox, when his artwork arrived, all these artists were mailing their work
to
my house when it was arriving. And Elliot's work, even though it says he's from UK, he made his work in Myanmar.
Oh, wow.
So I got this envelope from Myanmar. So that piece was actually created.
I hope you saved some of the stamps and things
I have
that.
I have all the envelopes saved.
So how did they created something? What did they just create it on paper, or did they
It was
use
all different materials. Yeah, so we have some on paper, we have some on fabric, canvas. We have a piece that's 3D printed. We have pieces that are just made out of cardboard. There's a whole variety of materials. There's a piece, the artist is Joshua Hagler. He's in Roswell, New Mexico, and he actually thought about how the piece would actually sort of go away in the course of the exhibit. So if you go see it, there's a railroad spike that's kind of embedded in it, and now part of it's missing, but yet you can see the void of where it used to be.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so it's really just beautiful. Like, some of the artists really took that into consideration.
Nice.
So how long is this? I mean, it is temporary. It is ephemeral. How long is this supposed to last?
Right. We're hoping to have the work stay up until early November. Yeah. So daylight, I mean, we're, you know, you should, if you come to see the museum, come during daylight hours, which this summer, you know, fall, it's still nice to go out and walk around town and listen to the stories. But by then we're into frost, and the works are going to be harder to keep up.
Has anybody figured out how long it takes to see all of the pieces?
No, and what I what originally I conceived is someone would come and spend the day listening, but I think that would almost be overload.
Yeah,
listening
I think
to so many
looking,
stories.
Looking
so maybe come and listen to a certain theme or just do a certain section of town, but see if you can take them in small doses,
yeah.
Because then I think it gives you time to really you know, enjoy them, savor
yeah.
them.
Yeah, I've just with the my Sundays at the market, I've been in such a hurry to get back to back home to cook that I haven't
yeah,
had the chance.
So
to
maybe
go
take
through.
The time to listen so, to one story.
I know, I have to do.
You go
I have
home.
To do.
Yeah,
I have to get up earlier. So, well, thanks so much, Mike. I'm really
sure.
looking forward to seeing more of them and checking it out and just finding them. So
fascinating project.
There's nothing
like it, and that's been it's nice. Thanks
I mean,
for having me on because I feel giving people the giving an explanation of it helps
yeah.
people really understand what it is.
Mm-hmm. Great.
Yeah, because it is a different thing.
So, well, let's move on. It is
great.
Time.
It is
also summer camp time. And I know Richard Bradbury from the Powell Center for the Arts at the Olivet Boys and Girls Club has the best summer camp ever. I love talking about this summer camp. I am not the only one that thinks it's the best, but lots of people do, and I know there's lots of kids that come back. So tell everybody about your summer camp and what really the most unique factor is.
Well, thank you for the lead-in. I think it's pretty spectacular, too, and for years I've been saying that it's probably one of Berks County's best-kept secrets, but hopefully this year the secret might be out. It is an 8-week summer theater camp. It is all arts process. We hit all of the theater disciplines. We take our kids, which we usually take about 33 to 35 kids, and I'm happy to report that as of today, we had 30 kids all signed up, and they must be between the ages of 9 and 18. So they are working with artists that are artists, like Mike here himself, like artists 365 days a year.
Yeah.
They are trained and experienced, and they might be theater directors, they might be musical directors, choreographers, other artists. We also work with a number of different organizations because we couldn't offer all this programming over 8 weeks by ourselves.
Yeah.
We have some wonderful partners in Reading Musical Foundation, and they offer 2 full weeks of complete musical immersion, where they are actually taking all of our 30, 35 kids through a process that's kind of a round robin for the first week that they will have experience working with on a guitar, African drumming, keyboarding, and also voice classes. They will get that for an entire week, and then the second week they actually specialize, and by the end of that second week, we have a sharing where all of the kids are performing. They have to pick something that they feel really passionate about, and that's what they will bring forth. Then the week, then 1 week prior to that, another partner that we have this summer, and we've had for the past 7, is Berks Opera Company, where Tammy Black and an accompanist and movement and performance artist Joel Gorey will be coming in and offering a full week of opera training and movement training. And they're going to be working on the magic flute. So all 35 kids will have the opportunity to work with Tammy and with Joel, developing pieces from the magic flute, and then that ends in a small sharing as well. But sort of the piece de resistance is at the final 4 weeks of summer, we will concentrate almost solely on the show that we offer, which is always a cut-down version of an existing scripted Broadway show. This year, we're going to be having our first repeat after 9 years. So we're coming back to Once on This Island. It fits us so well with the Caribbean beat and barefoot and stuff like that. And
perfect
so it gets
for
into
summer
that whole summer thing.
And
you're on the beach, you're on the island, lots of palm trees and things like that, and wonderful music. And a terrific story that's based on a Hans Christian Andersen original, The Little Mermaid, set in a very different locale with Caribbean music. And so we work on that almost solidly for 4 weeks. And at the end of that, we have 3 public performances that are free and open to the public, something that the Center for the Arts and Olivet Boys and Girls Club really stands for, is making art accessible to everybody. and especially where we're located in neighborhoods where that need us most, that the art is open and available for them to come in one time, two times, three times to see it. And then throughout the 8 weeks of summer, they have an opportunity to see their kids perform in three different things, whether it's the opera sharing, the musical immersion sharing, or the end of the summer performance of Once on This Island. So it's an incredible summer, and it sounds like we keep these kids working the entire time, but we really, really try to squeeze in a lot of fun summer things for them to do. Every Monday afternoon, we go to Olivet's Pool, which we're one of the few pools in the city anymore, a city that used to be filled with tons of playgrounds and tons of pools.
Yeah.
Yes, we have one of the few right now. And membership to it is for the entire community, as long as you are under 18, is $15, and you can go to Olivet's Pool for the entire summer.
That's amazing.
Yeah, after our camps are done during the day, after 3 o'clock on, it's open for $15 for children to join. But we take them there on Mondays, so they have half a day at the pool. Almost every Friday, we go up to our Blue Mountain Camp, which is above Hamburg. We back up to the Appalachian Trail. It's a beautiful camp, beautiful swimming pool, stocked lake, so they can swim, they can canoe, they have archery. We hike up to the Appalachian Trail.
So sort of the traditional summer camp activities.
Summer camp, getting city kids out of the city.
Amazing.
And really to break the wall of maybe where their school boundaries are.
Yeah.
It's a big deal.
That is huge. I mean, you know, to go up and see the Appalachian Trail.
Yes. That they start asking me, it's like, Mr. Richard, are there snakes? Are there bears? Because, you know, that this is a concern for inner city kids.
Sure. I can
imagine. And now with the news, you see a bear in Amity, you see a cougar in whatever.
Kumru.
Yeah.
Except it was a golden retriever, but
Was it really?
It was.
Okay.
Okay. Cougar, golden retriever, they're close.
Yeah, and then we also take them because part of our mission is to, if you're going to perform theater, we also feel that you have to see theater. So we will try to take our kids to local community theater in the area to see dress rehearsals and things like that, but we also take them for one trip. And another great partner we have is Berks Community Action Program. Because of them, they afford us the opportunity to take our kids to see professional theater. So this year, and I just booked it today, we're taking our, however many there ends up being, 30, 35 kids, to see Fulton Theater's production down in Lancaster of The Hunchback of Notre Dame, which really keeps trying to make it to Broadway, and it keeps hitting walls. But from what I've seen online, it looks like an incredible production.
And I want to talk about your summer camp, because there's so much I love about your summer camp. So you've got 30, 35 kids, mm-hmm. and every one of these kids auditions for a role. As soon as they walk in, you're trying to figure out. So, but do they all have to perform, or...?
That is one of the requirements, and it's actually one of the outcomes for us. We want the kids, because theater does such wonderful things for people's confidence, and we want them to have that sense of completion, that sense of getting to the end of something that is bigger than yourself.
Yeah, so it's all part of a team.
It really is, and so we push them to get to that, but there are auditions. Yeah. There are auditions, and the only caveat that we make is that if you are interested in a role that sings by themselves, that has a solo or a duet or something, then you must sing alone. But if you are comfortable being in the ensemble, and we always make sure that our ensembles are so much fun and they're doing so much. If you want to be ensemble only, which at times can be so much more fun than one of the leading roles, you do not have to sing alone, because I know that is huge. That to put yourself out there, in front of everybody, that's difficult.
Yeah.
So if there are kids that
I only sing alone in the car.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So if you only want to be in the ensemble, you certainly may.
So you have all these kids, they're in it. But the other thing that I love, I mean, like I said, there's so much I love great about this camp, and we've only got a couple minutes. Oh, yeah. So, who designs the sets?
Design. The idea definitely comes from the director. We have a terrific director. His name is Nate Rothermel. He's coming to us first time from Albright College. Wonderful people from Albright College. But We have a wonderful partnership up there with everybody in the theater community up at Albright College, but with Coco Bernal, she usually leads the way in for the director and I, because I'm usually the one that ends up building the set. But using Cocole and Nate's inspiration, they give me all that. They give me all that, and then we take off on it. But everybody ultimately helps.
All of
build
the kids
this set.
Help build
Absolutely.
The set.
Everybody at one point or another has their hand in this.
And the kids help with the costumes as well?
Absolutely. We do have a costumer, but once again, we get them to draw their costume. We want them to have some input on it.
So they help with the set. They help. Mm-hmm. They help with the costumes. You bring in a choreographer, but do the kids have input on the choreography?
Absolutely. If they come up with something terrific, and Janet Peck, who is our choreographer and has been for years, on and off, if she sees a move, it's like the best theater artists. It's like if you see something, you want to use it, and because it gives that child a sense of, I really have contributed to this. So it's like,
The collaboration of this, which is truly from start to finish, you know, and it really is a collaboration with the kids working with professionals and having their voice heard and feeling important. And then the pride at the end of it. I mean, this mm-hmm. is really... really such an amazing project. And I think once in this island, I'm really, you know, I hope that I actually make it out to see this because it's so great. You have to at least
We'd love
get
to
me
see
into
it.
A
it's
rehearsal.
It's a fun show, and they have such a great time. And I think it really hits on so many wonderful things that are so encouraging for young people to actually go through the process.
So how do they sign up? I know we
sign up at our website. Everything is done online now, which it looks like Karen has the website up. But on there's going to be a link. Now it doesn't appear in this one, but there's going to be a link that says online registrations. And from that there will be a pop down, a pop up list or a drop down list. We'll get that right. And you're going to be looking for the Center for the Arts. So we don't see it on here,
but it does exist.
It does exist, trust me.
And if kids have questions, they can go to any of the Olivet's centers.
Any Olivet center. This is not the only center that offers camps. Yeah. We offer the theater camp.
And any of the Olivet centers can help them sign up, correct?
Absolutely.
So, Olivet Boys and Girls Club, the Powell Center for the Arts, with amazing partners. And I'll give a quick plug that it has been chosen as one of the best in the state through the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts grant program, and hopefully we'll hear more about that soon. It is time to wrap it up, and I want to thank everybody for tuning in. This has been such an energetic show. Richard, thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Mike, thanks so much, and we look forward to seeing art and wandering around West Reading while singing the songs from Once on This Island. And when is it perform?
August 9, 10, and 11.
9, 10,
for
11,
free.
For free. All right. Thanks so much.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.